The M4 MacBook Air is pretty much the perfect computer for almost anyone in 2025, and it's the best MacBook Air Apple has ever come out with. But there's definitely a couple things about this computer that could be a little bit better. So in this video, we're going to talk about the M4 MacBook Air, my experience using it, and a couple of the features that I would love to see Apple upgrade and make even better for the M5 and beyond. The first thing to talk about is the sky blue color, which I almost didn't get, but honestly, it looks really cool. And the color of it kind of depends on the lighting of your room and even the angle that you're looking at the computer. It can go from looking like a silver to a dark silver to a slightly blue tinted computer. So I think Apple did a really good job with the color of the computer. The next thing that they added that is one of those features not a ton of people are talking about is you can now use the computer with two external displays and the built-in screen, which was a limitation with the past MacBook Airs, which is going to be a really great feature for users who use dual monitors and if you want to use your computer screen open for other productivity tasks as well. Also, it's still amazing how lightweight the MacBook Air is even after years of Apple making them, and you don't sacrifice anything in terms of typing performance and the overall day-to-day use. This is also a fanless design, which is a really nice thing because some of the old MacBook Airs had issues with the fans revving up and being really loud, and no one likes to listen to loud fans whenever they're doing work. The issue that this does cause, if you want to use this for more demanding workloads, then you can run into some issues with thermal throttling, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. So the typing experience is great and the day-to-day use of the computer is great. Everything feels really snappy, and Apple finally updated the base model of these machines to use 16 gigabytes of RAM, which we can all thank Apple Intelligence for, even though it's taking forever for them to come out with all the features. One thing that still drives me crazy with the MacBook Air is it still comes with just 256 gigabytes of storage if you get the base model, which is why I went ahead and went straight up to the 512, because 256 gigabytes is barely going to be able to hold any apps that you put on this if you plan on using this for any work beyond just cloud apps. If you're used to the 14, 15, or 16-inch MacBook Pros, the screen size on this computer may bother you a little bit just because everything feels a little bit tighter together. I really was only noticing this as an issue whenever I was doing apps like Final Cut Pro and I had a ton of different browsers open and I was trying to find clips and do other tasks like that within video editing, and I just had to get a little bit more creative with adjusting the workspace on the computer to fit everything into it. But if you use this with an external display, that's not going to be a problem, and that's how I'm running 99% of the time. Everything just plugs straight into external displays. While we're on the topic of screen, the screen's very sharp, very bright. It's amazing the quality Apple has in their screens, but this is just an LED display and the brightness tops out at 500 nits, which doesn't sound like it's going to be an issue for most people, but I was using it by the window the other day and it did get a little bit harder to see the screen because I had sunlight pointing directly at the screen. So if you're planning on using the computer outside a lot and you really need to be able to see, you might want to get the MacBook Pro instead. I think the screen quality and brightness is probably the main advantage of going for a MacBook Pro over the MacBook Air right now. But again, we'll talk more about the Pro here in a little bit. The next thing I want to talk about is the ports on the MacBook Air. So Apple gives you the MagSafe port, which is great for charging. There's two USB-C ports, which are actually Thunderbolt 4 speeds now, which is fantastic for keeping more peripherals plugged in. Unfortunately, none of the M4 base computers have Thunderbolt 5 available. I think that would be a nice option for even greater future expandability, but most users for the MacBook Air are not going to care that it only has Thunderbolt 4 ports on it. You also do get a headphone jack on the right side. The keyboard still has great features like the function row gives you everything you need to access, and you also have the Touch ID button, which works really well as well. Apple's also updated the webcam on this. It looks better than ever. They've added center stage, so if you move around the frame, the camera's going to follow you around, which looks a little cheesy, but it also is a nice effect if you're using this for things like FaceTime and you're really just trying to get your whole family in to see your friends and family.
Here's a test of the MacBook Air's webcam, and we've got center stage on, so it should kind of follow me around and keep me in the frame as I move a little bit. So it is a little bit cheesy looking, and to me, it kind of can look funny sometimes depending on how close or far away you get from the computer. So here's also going to be a good test to see what the sound quality you can expect out of the microphone is. And now we've turned center stage off so you can get an idea of what the camera looks like whenever you turn that off.
Apple also has done some of their speaker magic with this computer. It sounds pretty good, but if you're used to having a 14 or 16 inch MacBook Pro, you're not going to be quite as impressed by the built-in speakers in the MacBook Air. So if you're a power user and you really want to enjoy music quality and amazing sound quality, you're going to need something like AirPods or wired headphones, or full-size desktop speakers will be really great with this machine as well. The MacBook Air is a fanless design, which I really appreciate because it keeps your workspace very quiet no matter what you're working on. Just know if you're doing more intensive tasks, like if you're doing heavy video editing, or sometimes apps like Lightroom can make the computer start to heat up a little bit. So Where you're going to notice the issue of the lack of the fans with some thermal throttling is when you're doing those more intensive tasks. So if you're going to be doing a lot of video editing with this, I really recommend using an external keyboard and mouse so you can have the computer a little farther away from you and so that you're not touching it the whole time. It never got dangerously hot when I was using this on Final Cut Pro, but there were times when I was a little bit uncomfortable with my palms on top of the computer, and I switched over using my wireless mouse, and I like the experience a lot better on it. So the MacBook Air really used to only be for people who were doing productivity or basic office work or students. It didn't used to have the capability of running so many great apps, but I've been using base model M Series Macs for years for things like multi-track recording, video editing, and a variety of other production tasks, and these computers can handle pretty much anything you throw at them. I think the main difference between the Air and the Pro model is the lack of the fan, which will lead to thermal throttling under the heavier loads. And most users aren't going to be doing crazy things like I'm running this computer for. I was doing some multicam editing using multiple 6K clips. This machine was editing just fine, and it was able to spit out video exports of a 7-minute video in about 3 minutes and 45 seconds, which is pretty impressive for a MacBook Air. That's what's great about the MacBook Air is it's going to be able to handle even those heavy-hitting tasks in short bursts. I will say the reason I bought the Mac Studio is because I do so much video editing. I wanted something that was going to be able to export tons of videos a day so I could get all my work done. But whenever I'm doing the day-to-day general video editing tasks, like Final Cut Pro just runs so smooth on this. It's amazing to be able to skim. You don't see any drop frames. The only time I was running into issues with this is when I was really pushing it to the limit and just trying to actually do crazy stuff with this, like run so many 6K clips at the same time. And as soon as I switched it over from better quality to better performance, the computer immediately started working better. But many of Apple's apps have been putting out really great features that use the GPU and the CPU, and it just runs so smooth to see how all those machine learning tasks in Final Cut Pro are able to be rendered way faster than any old MacBook Pro was able to handle them. And whenever you're just doing your run-of-the-mill day-to-day tasks, email, documents, web browsing, you're not going to notice the computer getting hot at all. This thing just runs so long, the battery lasts forever, and it runs really cool even without having the fan on it. So I think the MacBook Air is a great option no matter what you do, but you just need to know if you're doing the heaviest, most demanding possible workloads, that's when you need to consider getting a MacBook Pro or getting a desktop instead. But really, I would recommend most users, if you're working at a desktop and that's where you're doing your heavy hitting, that's when you should get something like the Mac Studio so you can have the best possible thermal performance, the best possible desktop setup. Get the MacBook Air as your portable powerhouse that's able to handle small to large tasks in short bursts. The only other thing you really miss with the MacBook Air is you're missing the SD card slot, the built-in HDMI port, and there's one Thunderbolt port missing on the right side. So you don't get any ports on the right side except for the headphone jack, which is a little bit of an inconvenience with this that takes a little bit of getting used to. And you're probably going to have to use a dongle more often if you want to keep other accessories plugged into your computer at the same time. But at least you finally have MagSafe on this, so now you can charge with MagSafe and you can use your USB-C ports for devices instead of for charging, if you please. But this pairs really well with a desktop setup. It's going to work great with a Thunderbolt dock, with something like the Apple Studio display, or any USB-C monitor that's able to provide power. The MacBook Air used to top out at taking about 30 watts of power, but now it also supports 70-watt fast charging. So you can choose to either get this with the compact dual USB-C charger, or you can get it with the 70-watt single port charger instead. I would probably pick the 70-watt charger over the dual USB-C because that's going to charge this faster, but I have some other chargers I really recommend from Anker that are going to do a better job if you want to keep multiple devices charged instead. So the MacBook Air runs great and handles everything I've thrown at it. I love this computer because it's lightweight, it's compact, it's all you need in a computer. It's so fast, so snappy, so reliable. There's really not many bad things to say about it. The main things that I would love to see Apple update whenever they come out with the M5 MacBook Air is mainly the screen, and a couple of additional ports would be better as well. I know that they're trying to keep it thin, they're trying to keep it lightweight. That's probably part of why they didn't put all the ports in, but it would just be really nice if you did have that built-in SD card slot or at least an HDMI port on it. There's so many times where you want to plug this into a screen and you're doing some sort of presentation and people are always like, where's the HDMI dongle? So that is a big con to it. And you can get around this with things like Apple TVs and AirPlay. All the great Apple ecosystem features work fantastic on this computer, but those are some of the quality of life features that would make the MacBook Air an even better machine. One other thing I know some users are looking for is they're looking for an LTE modem in the computer as well. At this time, to me, it's not that big of a deal because I don't travel a ton, and you can always just use your phone if you want to hotspot. But if you had a LTE modem built into it, That would be another really nice feature for the MacBook Air. The other thing I do miss from the MacBook Air to the MacBook Pro is the brighter and higher quality display. This was something I wasn't really expecting, but after testing this with some sunlight shining on it, and just in my day-to-day use, there were times when I would be trying to turn the screen brightness up and realize that it was already maxed out on brightness. So I do really appreciate the MacBook Pro's screen brightness, also things like ProMotion so it has even smoother scrolling. It just makes the MacBook Pro's screen a little bit better than the MacBook Air. And last, the fans. I don't think Apple necessarily needs to add fans back into the MacBook Air because that's not really the point of it. But it's really interesting to me to see just how well this computer does perform even without fans. Really, the screen, the ports, and the fan are the only thing separating this from the MacBook Pro at this point. But I think for most users, this is honestly the computer to get. You should get the MacBook Air if you're doing pretty much anything, as long as you're not doing it under a sustained heavy workload. And when I say that, I'm talking video editing, 3D rendering, music recording. Those are the kinds of things where you would appreciate having a fan. You would appreciate higher performance. You can totally get away with doing them on this computer. It's just not going to run as efficiently or for as long of a time with this. One other thing I'd love to see Apple change is I think they need to get rid of the 256 gigabyte base model storage. If they could do the same thing that they did with the 16 gigabytes of RAM and make that the new standard, if this was $1,000 and it came with the 512 SSD, that would just be a steal. If you upgrade to the 512, it will cost you a little bit extra, but you will get some additional graphics cores as well. That makes it a good buy. And then if you go from a 13 inch to a 15 inch display, then the price does jump about $200 for the same exact spec'd out model. The 15 inch is also very nice. I'll have a comparison of the 13 and 15 inch at some point. To me, the 13 inch is the better choice just because it is a little bit more portable. But if you really need a little bit more screen real estate without going all the way up into the expensive MacBook Pro territory, then the 15 inch MacBook Air is also a great option for you. Overall, the M4 MacBook Air is an amazing computer. It's almost perfect, but Apple does have a couple small updates they could make to make the M5 MacBook Air even better. In the meantime, I highly recommend this computer for anyone who's looking for a MacBook Air. If you're doing any sort of productivity tasks, any sort of photo and video editing, this can handle it. Just know that depending on your use case, you may need a higher end Mac to be able to sustain those workloads. I have no problem recommending this for anyone who's looking for a great all-around computer with all the great Apple features we've come to know and love. Look for links in the description below for my favorite MacBook Air configurations, also for accessories I like. Also, if you need help picking out a computer, visit my website and fill out my form. I'll get back to you with personalized MacBook recommendations. Like this video, subscribe to the channel so you don't miss out on any upcoming content.